Welcome to the Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast, a part of the Knightline Sports Network. With me, your host, Sam Albuquerque. You can go ahead and follow me on Twitter at Sam B. Albuquerque. And if you want to get in touch with the show, go ahead and send me an email at sam.b.albuquerque@gmail.com. Albuquerque, spelled like the city in New Mexico. Please rate, review, and subscribe to the show. 5 stars are always appreciated. Before we preview the show, gotta hit some big housekeeping notes here. So, we are officially moving feeds this week. So if you're listening on the old feed, there will not be updated episodes after this week. And in the next week or so, the feed itself will no longer exist. If you're listening on Apple Podcasts, you'll have to subscribe to the Knightline Sports Network podcast feed. Knightline spelled like UCF Knight, K-N-I-G-H-T. That is where all the Knightline shows are hosted, including Sons of UCF, Knightline, and the AAC Report with Jeff Allen. A lot of good content. That will be the exclusive home of the Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast on Apple Podcasts. If you're listening on Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, iHeart, any other podcast app, there is going to be a second Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast feed. So you'll need to switch over to that one. Look for the Knightline Sports Network subheading. It should be there. I know it is on Spotify. I'm not specifically sure about Stitcher or Spreaker because I don't really use those apps personally. I know this is a little annoying to subscribe to one, subscribe to the other. I'm sorry about that. But I just want to let you guys know that 2 episodes into the show being on the Knightline Sports Network feed, it has been 100% worth it. The listenership has been through the roof, especially compared to me being on my own. It's been extremely awesome. So shout out to all of you listening, the Knightline community for showing love to a fellow Knight myself, and to Andrew Fagley for giving me the shot to be here. And with all that being said, we got a great episode planned for you guys. Today on the show, it's that time of the year where we run through Sam's Super Bowl checklist, the second annual Super Bowl checklist, where I tell you who can win the Super Bowl this year in the NFL. Obviously, the NFL, it's the Super Bowl, not the college football championship, whatever. By the way, finally talking some football here, right? Look at that. Third episode in, we finally got football in. So we're going to run through that in the first half of the podcast. Later on, we'll have Nick Gryniewicz, Nicky Football, host of Live Local and Loud, syndicated Live Local and Loud now, by the way, guys, on ESPN 690 in Jacksonville, as well as WDBO 107.3 FM and 580 AM right here in Orlando. We'll go through each division in the NFL and give you some thoughts on pretty much every squad, other than maybe the Jacksonville Jaguars, which I guess we'll give you some thoughts on that. This was recorded on Wednesday, the second before the Leonard Fournette announcement. I don't actually remember if we mentioned Leonard Fournette, but if we did, he is no longer on the Jags. He is now a part of the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. So keep that in mind when I talk to Nikki. Just remember that. But first,
yeah, so if you just take a left at Albuquerque, you'll get where you need to go.
See, you know, I knew I should have made a left turn at Albuquerque.
Here's your host, Sam Albuquerque.
It's the day. It is the day. It's time for the second annual Sam's Super Bowl checklist. Yes! I'm really excited about this, guys. This is one of my favorite things I do every year. Well, I guess every year starting now because I only did it last year. This podcast has only been around for about a year. Anyway, Sam's Super Bowl checklist is real simple. I have a checklist of things that teams have to meet to be able to win the Super Bowl. It's as simple as that. It's a real black and white formula. If you have these things, then you qualify to win the Super Bowl. If you don't, sorry. This is a rebuilding year for you then, or you're just trying to see stuff out. I've been right with this for about to be honest, it's not fair because I didn't really develop this theory until last year. I was right last year, but I went back and looked at every Super Bowl winner for 10 years, and they all match my criteria. I really reverse engineered the criteria to match what the last 10 Super Bowl winners were, and I started applying it last season, and the Chiefs obviously proved my point. So I'm just going to go through the criteria. There's 5 criteria that you need to meet as a football team to be considered a Super Bowl contender on my list. It doesn't mean that if you're on this list now, you will be even good next season. it does mean that you have everything to win the Super Bowl, in my opinion. And obviously, rookies come out of nowhere and attach themselves to winners. It really doesn't necessarily mean that these teams are the only ones that are going to be in contention for the Super Bowl. It just means that every Super Bowl winner in the past 10 years, I guess 11, including last season, have met this criteria. So I think these are the ones that are going to meet it this season, right? So the criteria is as simple as this. You need to get good to great quarterback play. All right, simple, good to great quarterback play. You need to have good to great coaching. Not necessarily the head coach, just coaching in general. You could have two really good coordinators and a mediocre head coach, or you could have all three, or just a really special D coordinator. You just have to get good to great coaching overall from your staff. You need good to great offensive line play. Again, not great specific offensive linemen, but as a unit, they have to play good to great. This one is the Patriots rule. Instead of good to great offensive weapons, instead of just phenomenal offensive weapons, the Patriots are the only team that made me adjust this, right? This specific criteria is you need versatile offensive weapons. They don't have to necessarily be good. They don't have to necessarily be great. They just need to be able to do multiple things. So the think Patriots when they beat the Rams. They didn't have great offensive weapons. They just had different types of dudes that were mediocre or average, but they were able to mold themselves into the defense's weakness to exploit that and be good. So, ergo, Patriots rule, versatile offensive weapons. And you may be thinking to yourself, you haven't mentioned defense once, right? That's because many teams haven't won Super Bowls with elite defenses. Like just last year, the Chiefs defense was not considered a great defense. Some people would not even consider it a good defense. What they did have, and what every team that have won a Super Bowl in the past 11 years I don't speak English very well. It technically is my second language. I moved here when I was like 3 or 4, and I speak English way better than I speak Portuguese, but whenever I mess up saying words in English, I just say it's my second language because it's a pretty solid excuse. Either way, you need one elite defensive unit. Chiefs had it last year with Chris Jones and Frank Clark on that defensive line. So you're probably a little skeptical. I'm just going to run through the past three winners of the Super Bowl because I did this last year with the entirety of the 10 Super Bowl winners. You can go listen to that one if you want. It's a little out of date because obviously I was talking about last year's team. But I'll just give you a quick preview, right? The Chiefs last year, Mahomes, elite quarterback, Reed, elite coach. Their O-line was top 10 in my opinion. They had amazing weapons, right? You know, Tyreek Hill, Travis Kelce, even Damian Williams. They had elite weapons. Chris Jones and Frank Clark, to me, were elite when it mattered. When it mattered in the playoff run, they were elite. Even towards the end of the season, Steve Spagnuolo had those guys playing really well. You look at the year before the Patriots, right? Brady, good to great. Belichick, all-time. O-line, no-brainer. Was a no-brainer. The weapons were just elite enough. They were just versatile enough. Gronk, Edelman, Josh Gordon. And that secondary was completely elite. But the rest of the defense was also great. But the secondary was that elite unit. You go to the year before that, the Philadelphia Eagles. Nick Foles was all time in that Super Bowl. Wentz was an MVP candidate. So they were at least good to great for a majority of that season. Doug Peterson and Frank Reich and Jim Schwartz were an amazing coaching staff. They were all elite. The offensive line, one of the best lines in football that season. We're talking about, you know, Lane Johnson on the right, Jason Peters on the left, even though Peters was hurt in the Super Bowl. I think Vaitai played that game. But still, Jason Peters for a majority of the season. Brandon Brooks, Jason Kelce, great interior linemen. So you give them the nod on the O-line. The weapons were good. Alshon Jeffrey was good. Zach Ertz was good. They had three good running backs in LeGarrette Blount. I think Corey Clement and Darren Sproles. Jay Ajayi was on that team too. And on the defensive side, that line was amazing that year. We all remember the Brandon Graham strip sack towards the end to win the Super Bowl, essentially. So that's just an example of if you reverse engineer my criteria, it matches for the next 10 seasons, essentially. And if you don't agree, I can you know, I can argue with you, whatever. You know, hit me up on Twitter. And like I said, I can keep going, but I'll stop here because I've done this already. These are the criteria that a team has to hit to win a Super Bowl for the majority of the NFL season. So I'm going to go ahead and not waste any more of your time. I'm going to give you the teams that can check the boxes and subsequently win the Super Bowl this season, with the avid caveat of who the hell knows what's going to happen with COVID-19. We're just going to ignore that for this conversation. Just talk football. We're going to go ahead and start with the defending champions themselves, the Kansas City Chiefs. Let's go ahead and put the most obvious one on the list first, right? Save the spicy ones for the end. Mahomes is the best quarterback I've ever seen. He is perfection at the position, plain and simple. Check the QB box. You don't even have to question it. Andy Reid, elite offensive mind with Eric Bieniemy running the show. Spags got a really good showing from that defense last year. This is an elite coaching staff, in my opinion, especially on the offensive end. Check the coach box. We're good. O-line, Mitchell Schwartz, Eric Fisher are a very good, maybe even great tackle combination. Schwartz by himself is an elite right tackle. The interior of the line isn't perfect, but as a unit, and especially including Mahomes' ability to improvise and get the ball out quick when he wants, they're at least good. They're probably great. Check that box. Let's move on to the weapons, right? Awesome, versatile. Can't say anything really bad about Tyreek Hill and Travis Kelce. They're both elite in their positions. Clyde Edwards-Helaire might be awesome. I'm hearing a lot of Brian Westbrook comparisons from guys in that organization. So even though they're not going to have Damian Williams, who was a really good player and probably should have won Super Bowl MVP last year, Clyde Edwards-Helaire was a first-round pick for a reason. An Andy Reid running back, man, they're always good. So you have to believe that he's at least going to be serviceable, at least versatile enough to do something out of the backfield. He caught the ball pretty well at LSU. And Sammy Watkins, very serviceable second receiver. They can do some stuff. They've had a couple players here and there. And it really doesn't matter because Pat Mahomes is just that good that he'll make anybody great. So check the skill position versatility box. I don't know what I'm saying. English is my second language. See, I told you guys I would make that joke. Defense. This was the biggest question mark last season, and still the one I kind of have. I have some doubts about this, if they have an elite defensive unit. I still think that Frank Clark and Chris Jones are elite players that can make this D-line unit elite. So I'm going to go ahead and check the box. It's still the box that you stop at, but you check it because they're just going to be that good. So congrats to you, Chiefs Kingdom. You can win the Super Bowl this season. You probably already knew that. You didn't need me to tell you. Next up on the list, who check all the boxes, my Baltimore Ravens. Best record in the NFL last season and the MVP on the roster. Plug some holes, put them on the list. They're there. Let's start off with Lamar. He's the MVP, and by definition, he's great. If he can stay healthy, he's going to perform well. There are questions about his playoff performance. He's 0-2 in the playoffs. They're fair. He hasn't played well in his two playoff appearances. He's lost both of them. Let's give him a little bit of a break here. Let's give him a little bit of time before we say he can't win big games. Check the box. He was the MVP. Move on. Harbaugh, Roman, and Wink are, in my opinion, my humble opinion, the host of this show, the best combination of head coach, offensive coordinator, and defensive coordinator in the NFL. It's not even a question. Check the coach box. O-line, not as definite as it's always been with the Ravens. Marshall Yanda is gone. They're still very good even without him. The tackles are very good, if not great. Ronnie Stanley was an all-pro left tackle last season. We'll see if the play drops in the interior a little bit, but I doubt it won't be good, if not great this season. So check that box. Offensive weapons was the biggest question mark to me on this team last year. There was a heavy reliance on rookies and non-starting veterans, guys who came over and weren't starters or weren't stars at other places. It's less of a question this season. The running game is the best in the NFL. When you add J.K. Dobbins, it just gets even better. Hollywood looks like he's every part of a number one wide receiver. Mark Andrews is starting to creep into that elite tight end group with George Kittle and Travis Kelce and Zach Ertz. He may be fourth, but he's getting real close to that. To me, it's not even a question that they're versatile enough and good enough this season to compete for a Super Bowl. Check that box. This defense might have two elite units and one good unit, to be honest. Matt Judon, sick last season. They're adding Calais Campbell and adding a little bit more depth with Derek Wolfe. They have Brandon Williams, obviously, so that D-line is sick. The secondary, even though they lost Earl Thomas, who everyone hated, by the way, I'll talk about Earl Thomas a little later with my buddy Nick Gryniewicz on the second half of this podcast, they still have two all-pro level corners in Marlon Humphrey and Marcus Peters. Check this box twice, and if Patrick Queen can be the first-round linebacker that we drafted, by the way, we draft Hall of Fame caliber linebackers in the first round. Ray Lewis, one. Who else? C.J. Mosley. So check that out. We'll probably, that'll probably be another elite defensive unit. So congratulations, Ravens flock, and me. Our team can win the Super Bowl this season. Moving on, next up on the list are the one and only Dallas Cowboys. They were on this list last year. I've come to regret it, but I'm going to make the same mistake I made last year. I'm going with the Dallas Cowboys. They're one of the best rosters in the NFL, especially now that Jason Garrett isn't getting in the way. This team might go 16-0. Okay, that's how good I think the Cowboys are. No, I'm kidding. That's just how bad I think Jason Garrett is. So, first up, obviously, we're going to talk quarterback. Dak proved last year he could chuck it all over the yard and put up massive numbers in a progressive style offense. Add a better head coach in continuity with Kellen Moore as the OC. Dak is at least good this season, if not an MVP candidate. That might be, by the way, my low-key hot take of this year. And we'll do hot takes next week. Right now, I think that's what it might be, but that's not the point. The point is Dak will be good, maybe great. Check that box. Mike McCarthy is a Super Bowl winning head coach. He's a grown-up, and I think he's got something he wants to prove. He's at least good, might end up being looked at as great after this season. I don't love Mike McCarthy, but I can't deny the fact that he's at least a good head coach. Check that box, move on. The O-line. So, in the past, this has been one of the biggest no-brainers on this roster. It's still a no-brainer to me because they have three all-pro caliber players on this offensive line. Tyron Smith, Zach Martin, and Lyle Collins. I get it, Collins hasn't been an all-pro player yet, but I think he can be. They'll be just fine without Travis Frederick, I think. I get it, the center just, he's the quarterback of the offensive line or whatever, and sort of the brain of the offensive line. I think they'll be fine without Travis Frederick. Dak isn't a rookie. He can figure out protections on his own. They're probably going to be great again, especially if they're healthy, which is always a caveat, especially with Tyron Smith. Check that box. Weapons, no-brainer of this roster. CeeDee Lamb, Amari Cooper, Ezekiel Elliott, Mike Gallup, Tony Pollard, and even Blake Jarwin, who I don't think gets enough credit, by the way. This is one of the best offensive groupings in the NFL. They're versatile. They're great. I don't have any reservations in checking this box. The defensive unit is the biggest question mark to me because it's the linebackers. It's not that this linebacking core isn't elite or that I even question if they are elite. It's because they're linebackers. Usually my theory of one elite defensive unit, it's either the secondary or the defensive line. Linebackers are rarely the unit only because nowadays, a lot of the time, there's only like one or two of them on the field. Nonetheless, Jalen Smith, Leighton Vander Esch, and Sean Lee are an elite unit of linebackers. The D-line isn't bad either, which gives me a little bit more confidence in this pick. Check the box. But this is the biggest question on this roster. So congrats to Jerry Jones and no one else. You can win the Super Bowl this season. Chugging right along here. Next up on the list, the Minnesota Vikings. Probably a little bit of a surprise coming from me, especially at the quarterback position. But after last year and their playoff win, I cannot be too cavalier in saying anything mean about Kirk Cousins. So I'm going to go ahead and be as neutral as I can towards Cousins. Okay, Kirk is good. He's not great. He's not elite. He's just good. The box says good to great at quarterback. Not elite. Not very good. Only just good. And Cousins is good. I don't like that. Check the box. Zimmer and Kubiak. Mike Zimmer and Gary Kubiak are both one of, if not the most elite coaches at their respective sides of the football. To me, this is a no-brainer. I think Mike Zimmer might be a top five defensive coordinator, defensive mind in the NFL. Gary Kubiak might be the same sort of level on the offensive end. Granted, Stefanski was good last year. Obviously, Kubiak was there as a consultant, sort of like overseeing Stefanski. And Stefanski added some elements that were a little bit more modern. Kubiak is an old school type of guy. He loves that zone read, or not zone read, that zone running scheme that, you know, the Shanahans have made famous. So you'll probably lose a little bit of creativity, but what you're going to gain in just professionalism and just experience and just flat out good football coach. And Gary Kubiak, doesn't matter. By the way, Super Bowl winning head coach Gary Kubiak. Never forget that. Check that box. They've spent some capital trying to build this O-line, and it's the biggest question mark on this roster. But I think Garrett Bradbury at center and adding some depth in the draft, they'll be just good enough. You could call them, if you will, the Kirk Cousins of offensive lines. Check the box. Elite defensive unit. Pretty much this entire defense is elite other than the cornerbacks. The safeties, elite. Anthony Harris and Harrison Smith are great. Linebackers, Eric Kendricks, Anthony Barr, elite. Defensive line, they just brought in Yannick Ngakoue. By the way, I learned how to say this, Yannick and not Yannick. Later on in the podcast, me and Nick will have that conversation. Because I recorded that part before this part. It doesn't matter. You'll listen to it. It's Yannick. It's not Yannick. Either way. Yannick Ngakoue, Daniel Hunter on one side. This is their biggest no-brainer to me. Even bigger than the coaching box. I think they have various elite defensive units. So check that box. Congrats, Skull. Is that what you guys say? I don't know what you guys say. I think it's Skull. You can win the Super Bowl this season. Moving on. The New Orleans Saints. One of the most prolific quarterback and coach duos. Back for another run while adding some more offensive weapons and improving the defense. Sign me up. Look, you look at Breeze. He has become a question. He is no longer elite, but I think he's still good. I think the addition of Sanders and having that creativity offensively that Sean Payton brings to any squad he's a part of, they're going to help maintain him at least on a good trajectory this season, if not a little bit closer to great. Check that box. I just trust Drew Brees, and I think that's the biggest part of that. Like I mentioned earlier, Sean Payton is one of the best head coaches in the NFL. No question to me. Check the box. Move on. Offensive line, another no-brainer. This is a top five offensive line. Armistead, McCoy, Ramchek, they're great. Andrews Pete, he's good. They have some depth. They're all elite together. No brainer. Check the box. Weapons got even better. Obviously, we all know you can't guard Mike, Alvin Kamara, Jared Cook, Emmanuel Sanders, and even Taysom Hill add a lot of versatility with what you can do here. You can even add Latavius Murray, who's more of a traditional back, whereas Alvin Kamara can catch the ball out of the backfield and do a bunch of different things. They got straight-up firepower here. One of the best offensive units in football, I think. Check that box. The D-line, it's elite. The secondary is good, along with DeMario Davis being awesome in the linebacking core. Not much of a question on their defense, period. Not a no-brainer, but it's pretty easy to give them this one. Check that box. Congrats, Who Dat Nation. You can win a Super Bowl this season, assuming some other bizarre thing doesn't happen to you, like the Minnesota Miracle or the Rams' inexplicable missed call there with pass interference. Who knows? Maybe you guys are just cursed. It's a lot of voodoo stuff down there in New Orleans. Let's move on. The Tampa Bay Buccaneers. When you add the greatest quarterback of all time to your team, you get on the list. It's as simple as that. Brady, though not phenomenal last year, there's no doubt in my mind he will be at the bare minimum of good this year. He might be phenomenal this year. You know how many... He's got so many weapons. And they just added Leonard Fournette. Wow. Anyway, check that box. Coaching box. Arians and Leftwich in the offense. Obviously, Leftwich is a little bit of an unproven commodity, but Bruce Arians has so much stock built up on the offensive end that I almost trust Brian Leftwich because Bruce Arians trusts him. And Todd Bowles. I like the staff a lot, and they'll be good. At least good. Probably great. O-line is a question, but they did draft a tackle in the first round from Iowa, Tristan Wirfs. Donovan Smith at the left tackle. He isn't bad. They paid Ali Marpet and Ryan Jensen, so I'll assume they're good too. They'll be good enough, especially because Tommy gets it out quick. Weapons. Best part of this offense, man. Best part of this team. Evans and Godwin alone? Wow. Then you add Gronk and Howard and Brate, Fournette, Ronald Jones, Kayshon Vaughn, LeSean McCoy. They're great. Versatile. No-brainer. Defense. That defensive line was the best defensive line unit last season in the NFL. Shaq Barrett came out of nowhere, and Ndamukong Suh essentially revitalized his career. Vita Vea? Who cares? He wasn't bad. JPP, also not bad. So, elite. Plus, you expect a little bit more from Devin White. The corners weren't that bad this year, or past last year, not this year. Congrats, Bucks fans, or whatever you call yourselves. I feel like there's a nautical pun there, or at least a joke. Maybe like deckhands. Congrats, deckhands. You know what I'm thinking. Either way, congrats to you. You can win the Super Bowl this year. Next up on the list, let's stay in the NFC here and go to the San Francisco 49ers. They were the champs of the NFC last year, returning with a really similar squad. And to be honest, as long as Kyle Shanahan is there, I'm probably going to be all in. Jimmy G is good, better than Kirk Cousins, in my opinion. But they do live on the same street in the same neighborhood, but I would prefer Jimmy G over Kirk Cousins. So give Garoppolo a nod there. Check that box. I love me some Kyle Shanahan. Easy check for me. Throw in a little Robert Saleh, and the box was checked before I even woke up this morning. I walked off the bus. Box checked in the coaching rank. The O-line is good. They are losing Joe Staley, who is retiring, but they're replacing him with a former Pro Bowler, I think maybe even an All-Pro in Trent Williams. If Williams was even half the player we last saw, he's going to be a Pro Bowl level left tackle. Mike McClinchy was a first-round pick last year and was serviceable. The zone blocking scheme on the interior that the Shanahans have perfected is going to be elite because that's what they do, even if the players aren't. They'll be closer to great than good this season. Check the box. Weapons are interesting. Not a clear yes for me, but George Kittle, being the beast he is, and Kyle Shanahan being the offensive genius he is, they're versatile enough. Deebo Samuel and Brandon Ayuk are going to be fun to watch. Raheem Mostert or whatever seventh round undrafted running back is back there, they'll be good enough because Shanahan's just that creative and they're just that inventive that it's going to work. Oh, yeah, and you throw in Kyle Juszczyk, who's the highest paid fullback in the NFL. That dude is awesome. I watch them in Baltimore all the time. What they do with him in San Francisco is so much fun. Check that box. Their D-line is going to be elite. It's not really a question. I am wondering how big of a loss DeForest Buckner will be. I know they drafted Javon Kinlaw from South Carolina. I like Javon Kinlaw. I love DeForest Buckner. So we'll see. But it's clearly not enough of a question to wonder how good they'll be. That's going to be a check. Nick Bosa is still there. D Ford is still there. They're going to be elite at that position. Congrats, Niner Nation. You can win the Super Bowl this year, according to me anyway. All right. This is it, guys. This is a spicy one. This is going to be fun. I like this. As a Ravens fan, this hurts me. But the Pittsburgh Steelers can win the Super Bowl this year. They check all of my boxes. Yes, I said it. They went, I think, 8-8 last season with Mason Rudolph and a guy named Duck starting at quarterback. They're getting back their Hall of Fame quarterback in Big Ben. Yes, sure, he can't stay healthy. But he's still a massive upgrade to what they had last season. I think he'll at least be good this year, maybe even great. He has the capacity to do it. Check that box. Mike Tomlin is an elite coach, and no one should ever question his acumen. He's a Super Bowl winning coach, and a lot of people assume that was because of Big Ben. We saw last season how good of a coach Mike Tomlin really is, dealing, you know, with Antonio Brown and then him leaving and then blowing up the way he did in Oakland and New England. It's kind of wild that he was able to keep that locker room together the way it was while AB was there. We know how big of a drama queen Big Ben is, or drama king, whatever. I don't know if that was offensive or not. If it was, I apologize. We know how annoying Big Ben is. Let's go with that. Mike Tomlin's elite. He manages these egos better than any other coach in the NFL. Mike Tomlin, check the box. This O-line has been elite in the past. They're starting to get up there in years. The Pouncey, you know, twin that's up there. I forget if it's Marcus or Marquise. I honestly don't even know. I don't know which one. They have a Pouncey, though. He's always hurt. But he's a good offensive lineman. I was going to say defensive lineman. That was wrong. David DeCastro, one of the highest paid guards in the NFL. I think he's great. Villanueva's pretty good. I think they can be good this season, especially if they can stay healthy. Pouncey, I'm talking to you. Weapons are the biggest question. Are Juju, Connor, and Ebron enough? I think the answer to that question is maybe. But I think they check the box because the Steelers figure out the wide out position better than any other team in the NFL. They just do. This is a vote of confidence in this team's ability to find guys like Antonio Brown, Juju Smith-Schuster, Emmanuel Sanders, Hines Ward, and other guys from late rounds or just like off the street. I assume because they're so good at that, I think they need just one more wide receiver to be versatile enough. They aren't currently with Juju, James Conner, Eric Ebron, and Vance McDonald. I think one of either Chase Claypool, who they drafted out of Notre Dame, James Washington, who I think is a second-year guy, Deontay Johnson is also a second-year guy. One of those guys needs to be a starter-level player. And I trust this team, this coaching staff, whoever their wideout coach is, to help mold one of those dudes into a legitimate starter in the NFL. And I think that's enough for me to check that box. Defensive unit, the whole front seven is elite. Let's be real here. I get they lost Javon Hargrave to Philly, but I still think they're going to be special defensively, at least as a whole this season. The safeties are awesome. Minka Fitzpatrick and Terrell Edmonds. The D-line is elite. I think, you know, T.J. Watt, Bud Dupree, Cam Hayward, I think they're going to be great this year again. I think Devin Bush might really come on this season as well. And Joe Hayden, still a good corner. No-brainer. Check that box. Pittsburgh Steelers, congratulations. You can win the Super Bowl this season. That hurts my feelings to say, by the way. So that's it. Those are the teams that I think can win the Super Bowl this season. Let's just start from the top, and I'll just remind you guys. We got the Kansas City Chiefs, the Baltimore Ravens, the Minnesota Vikings, the Dallas Cowboys, the New Orleans Saints, the Tampa Bay Bucks, the San Francisco 49ers, and the Pittsburgh Steelers. Those are the squads I think can win the Super Bowl this season. I did, however, go through a couple other squads, and there were some that were honorable mentions. So I'll go through those right now and just tell you why I don't think they have what it takes to check all the boxes. Start with the Seattle Seahawks. I don't trust that offensive line. Never will. Ever since they won that first Super Bowl, they've just been declining in quality. And to be honest, let Russ cook. We'll talk about that with Nicky Football coming up. And I'm not sure if their defense has an elite unit. I'm really not. Bobby Wagner is elite. That's really about it. That defensive line and that front seven were, in my opinion, were elite last season because of Jadeveon Clowney. He's not there right now. I don't know where Clowney's going to end up. He's still a free agent. The season's about to start in 2 weeks. Jadeveon Clowney still hasn't gotten paid. That's insane to me. The New England Patriots. Their lack of weapons is probably the biggest question mark and why I don't think they check that box. But I'm also curious to see what Cam Newton's going to do. I don't want to give him that box because I'm too scared of injury. I try not to think about injuries when I do this because every team has injuries. I just think Cam is a special case just because he's been hurt so often for the past, I don't know, like 2 or 3 years. The Philadelphia Eagles. Injury is the question there, but trying to disregard that, the offensive line play is going to be a huge question to me. Lane Johnson is great. Brandon Brooks is out. He's out for the year, I think. Andre Dillard, out for the year, starting left tackle. Jason Peters, always hurt and old. He came back to play guard. He's going to have to play left tackle. So, cut them out. The Houston Texans. I don't trust Bill O'Brien. I understand Bill O'Brien, the coach, won with Tom Savage or Brian Hoyer or Ryan Fitz. I get that. I just don't trust Bill O'Brien to win anything more than a wild card playoff game. So, he doesn't check that box. I also have some questions about the defensive unit. You know, I like Whitney Mercilus. I like J.J. Watt. But if they still had Jadeveon Clowney, there's a real conversation about that defensive line. Not anymore. I think J.J. Watt is a little bit older. Whitney Mercilus is great, but just There's not enough juice to me on that defensive line. They're out. And the last team, honorable mention, Green Bay Packers. There's a real lack of weapons on that team, and really to the point that I think Aaron Rodgers is justified in being pissed off that they drafted a quarterback in the first round and not a wide receiver. Either way, the lack of weapons really does it for me. And even though I like Matt LaFleur as a coach, and even though I like Aaron Rodgers as a quarterback, and I think they both can be good to great, their relationship might really affect the play on the field. And I even think that they're not going to have a great season. I'll dive in a little bit on that with Nikki Football coming up. But that's the main reasons why the Packers aren't on the list. But that's it. I'm sorry if you're one of those honorable mention teams, or if I didn't say your name at all, Browns, Bengals, Colts, Dolphins, Jets, whoever you are, Arizona Cardinals. I don't know what team you support. I'm sorry. Not your year. Maybe next year.
Hey, this is Travis Dever, Kai's Real Estate, the Dever team, New Smyrna Beach. Your source for real estate and everything else, New Smyrna Beach. Proud sponsor of Knightline. Call me anytime at 386-690-1636. That's 386-690-1636. Let me show you my hometown, New Smyrna Beach, UCF's favorite beach. Go Knights and charge on.
An auto accident can change your life forever. At Chad Barr Law, we are raising the bar on what to expect from your personal injury attorney. Hi, I'm Chad Barr, and I want you to know that our entire team is dedicated to providing you with the representation you deserve in your greatest time of need. If you or a loved one have been injured in an auto accident, call 407-599-9036 for a free consultation or visit chadbarlaw.com. At Chad Barr Law, our clients come to us in need and leave as family. Offices, Altamont Springs.
Back here with Nikki Football, as always, host of Live Syndicated, Live Local and Loud. We haven't talked about this yet on the podcast, at ESPN 690 Jacksonville, as well as WDBO here in Orlando. How do you feel being a big-time syndicated host now?
Well, I don't think it's syndicated. I think it's simulcasted when it's two markets. I think it's syndicated when you get to three. I would love to call it syndicated. Listen, I mean, we're feeling it out. We're starting to get to know our audience there in Jacksonville. I'm getting to know the city of Jacksonville, the sports scene there.
Have you made a migration up to Jacksonville to talk to the people and see what they think as far as sports? What do they want to listen to? Is it a lot of Georgia Bulldogs?
It's SEC football. Jacksonville Jaguars.
Pretty much.
That is the main two.
Not basketball fans up there in Jacksonville?
Listen, I mean, the NBA playoffs, in terms of the trending stories, the Magic are actually pretty big up there, too, which surprised me when we first started doing the show. But it's a lot of Jacksonville Jaguars, so the Leonard Fournette, Yannick Ngakoue, Doug Marrone situation.
Is it Yannick? I always called him Yannick.
It's Yannick. I found out that it is Yannick, yeah.
Well, I mean, now you have to know, because exactly. The 690 listeners are all going to be, hey,
if you
you're
listen,
saying it wrong.
If you listen to the show, you can hear me hedging on all of these things. So, I mean, you can hear me like, you know, Yannick, you know, I'll say it four different ways. It's the same thing when we're talking Clemson football, and I'll say Dabo, then Dabo, so that if anyone's listening, you never really know.
Half the time, you'll get it right.
I can't say Dabo Sweeney's name
is
right.
Is it Sweeney or Swinney?
I don't know.
The other one.
I can't say it
right.
Do you
go Dabo Sweeney or Dabo Swinney, or do you have a way to you say it specifically? Like every time you say Dabo, you say Sweeney or Sweeney?
The last name I'm not focused on. Everyone is focused on the Dabo one. Dabo thing, which the rumor this week of him potentially being on the move to Jacksonville was... I have not had a laugh like that.
That
in a long
is the stupidest
time.
Thing I've ever heard.
It's ridiculous.
There's
it's,
nobody in college football that I associate more with college football than Dabo Sweeney. Like, I don't view him as a professional coach.
I don't think the guy that has said in the past, once the players start getting paid, I quit, is the right guy to be in a professional locker room. It sounds like an absolute pipe dream for the Jacksonville Jaguars. And I don't know if the God family football thing works in professional locker rooms. Those guys are about... Get me paid and winning. And
yeah,
it's
when,
in that
when
order.
Yannick Ngakoue is yelling at Shad Khan and his son,
on
Dabo
Twitter.
Sweeney is probably out at that point. Like, you know what? I like being the owner, the CEO, the president, the whatever, in charge of everything person.
They got to detonate the whole thing, and I'm a Doug Marrone fan. I think Doug Marrone is a very... Oh, yeah, I am. I'm a Doug Marrone fan. The guy has won at Syracuse. No one wins at Syracuse other than him and Dino Babers. The guy has won in Buffalo. No one, unless they ripped out, after they ripped down that entire GM organization situation, then it got better there, of course, but he won there and walked away. And he made the AFC Championship game as the head coach of the Jacksonville Jaguars. Tom Coughlin was the big mistake there.
Yeah.
Tom Coughlin ruined everything.
We'll find out now.
We'll see.
This roster this year is not built to win. We'll see if they keep him around for the rebuild coming up, you know, if Shad Khan decides to, you know, kick out David Caldwell.
It's not looking good.
It really isn't. But what's more of a pipe dream? Dabo leaving college football or Dabo going to Jacksonville because he wants to be a professional coach?
I feel
like it's definitely college football, but it's even more of a joke that he would go to Jacksonville.
Yeah, that's the thing, is I think that if Dabo were to leave Clemson, he would have his pick of a couple of programs.
Yeah.
I mean, Matt Rhule was at Baylor.
Yeah.
And Matt Rhule
could have gone to the Giants. Could have gone to the Panthers.
He had teams fighting over him. Absolutely.
And not even fighting him, paying him.
Yes. I said on Live Local and Loud this week that if I were Dabo and the Jacksonville Jaguars called me, I'm not asking for the Matt Rhule 7-year deal.
Yeah.
I'm talking about a decade. I want a 10-year deal.
I don't want a Gruden deal. I want ownership, dude. Give me 49% of the ownership, because that's what it's going to take.
I'm trying to think of what would be a good landing spot for him. And the first one that comes to mind, the Houston Texans. Deshaun's there.
That makes a
ton of
sense.
Deshaun's there, baby.
Deshaun loves him.
I think Bill O'Brien's Teflon. Bill O'Brien's not getting fired. Bill O'Brien's
Well, he's not going to fire himself.
No, exactly. Exactly. That's the thing. That's why I don't get fired from Live Local and Loud. I'm the boss there, so it doesn't. That's why I don't get fired necessarily. But when the Bill O'Brien thing, if indeed Dabo does have that itch,
yeah,
that would be the one. That would be the one.
Yeah. If Deshaun is like, hey Dabo, I let's win some titles here now. You know, or I guess one title here.
It's time to turn Houston into the winner that we turned Clemson into.
Yeah, I feel like with Dabo, it's got to be like a prestige thing. It's got to be like the Cowboys. Like, I get the connection with Deshaun, but I think it's got to be one of those.
So
big,
this is like the Lincoln Riley.
Yeah,
okay.
it's got to get a guy, especially Dabo. Like, Lincoln's different because I feel like he's so creative that he'll want to see his creative process applied in the NFL at the highest level. Whereas Dabo, like, I don't necessarily think he wants to go, and it has to be something bigger. He's very, you know, God, family, football, that sort of guy.
Right.
Those kind of guys, I know those kind of guys. I've grown up in Southern Baptist churches here. Those guys aren't attracted by, you know, the players, the money. They're attracted of the prestige, the legacy,
organizations.
The Cowboys, the 49ers, the Patriots.
What about the Atlanta Falcons then?
No.
Right part of the country.
It is, but not the specific city though.
New Orleans
Saints?
I don't feel like Sean Payton hangs them up.
Not enough prestige. I don't think.
Okay.
I think you're right about both of those. It's got to be one of the bigger. Maybe the Packers. Packers could fit.
Yeah. I don't know.
Trevor Lawrence gets there.
That's got the prestige. But if I'm going to, it's got the Packers have the most prestige. But I want to go to a team also that's going to spend some money.
Yeah,
and the Packers are big, you know, kind of like big prestige, small wallet.
Yeah.
I want the wallet to match
the Cowboys' prestige and the wallet.
Exactly. That's what I want.
I mean, we're saying all this, but I do not think Dabo leaves college football, period. If he's going to leave Clemson, it's going to be Bama, right?
That's how it feels.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how it feels. And I actually don't know why you would leave Clemson for Bama other than the aforementioned prestige. No one wants to be the guy that follows Nick Saban, A. And B, the ACC is trash.
Yeah. Exactly.
I mean, Miami's not getting it back, at least doesn't look like. Florida State, we'll see what Mike Norvell turns this thing into. But James Blackman is now the starter for what feels like the fourth straight head coach. It's the third straight, but it's the fourth straight offensive coordinator because they don't have anything better.
It really feels like DeAndre Francois was, like, just there.
Yeah,
like,
it was last.
No, I know, but, like, James Blackman has played that long. And
yes.
From that 1 year that we saw Francois, and he was pretty good. And then
don't forget
hurt.
The week zero game against Bama. That's the one.
Yeah,
I think that was it.
Yeah.
That was two apartments ago for me. That's how I know it. Because I was sitting in a completely different apartment in a completely different place, and Francois gets hit, and all of a sudden they've got this kid that's 120 pounds soaking wet on the field, and he has earned the starting job now. Norvell, Taggart, Jimbo. Maybe he's got something. I don't know.
I mean, who knows? We'll find out this year if there is football. And that leads me to the first conversation here.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know how to feel about football happening. It's supposed to start like in less than 2 weeks. Look, the schedule in front of me right here, the first game is on the 10th.
Yep.
It is what day are we recording this?
It's a week from Thursday. Yeah.
It's 8 days away.
Yep.
We're 8 days away from football.
Can't wait.
I don't believe it's going to happen yet. Like, I still don't. Like, I know it's going to. Like, if they're going to kick off in football, it's going to be a little different. It just feels so weird right now. For the NFL, obviously, we talked college football this entire time, but we're going to talk NFL.
Yeah, we're
going to
go NFL here. Yeah. That's fine. And by the way, the aforementioned Deshaun Watson is in that game because the Thursday night game, Houston Texans against the Super Bowl champion, Kansas City Chiefs. It's still weird to say that. By the way, who got the bigger ring last night? Was it Pat Mahomes or his now fiance? Oh my God,
future Brittany Mahomes. Is it Brittany? I think it's Brittany.
I think you're right. Yeah.
She got the bigger ring. That was massive, dude.
What did you focus more on, The Rock or the shrimp that were in the background? Did you see the shrimp in the background of the photo?
No,
Jumbo. Yeah. Everything in that photo.
I
was
very
jumbo.
Distracted by the large ring that was the size of like my head.
It was
It was massive, dude. Yeah. And as someone in the market for rings, I'm praying my girlfriend doesn't see that. Even though I saw it immediately, I was like, she doesn't want one like that because it's a square diamond.
Yeah.
She likes
the
round.
Is that the princess cut?
No. I have no idea.
I forget what that's
called. Tiffany cut, maybe?
I don't know. I went my fiance wanted the marquee diamonds.
I have no idea what that means.
It's shaped like a football, which made me immensely happy. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Her diamond's shaped like a football.
She is going to be Mrs. Nikki Football.
Yes. She is in, what do I have, 5 weeks here? I got 5 weeks.
Look at that. Wow. Look at that. Proud of you. It's only been, what, 11 years?
11 years in December.
God. Huh.
I tried to escape the pocket.
Yeah,
there.
I'm not letting you. No. Not letting you. You're seeing ghosts. There's Sam Darnold right now.
Like Von Miller in the backfield. You just grabbed me and threw me down.
How did she hold you, like, to get to this point for almost 11 years, a decade plus one, until Nikki Football actually is going to tie the knot?
Well, let's be honest. I think all of that's about her. That's not about me. We have enough friends. I have enough friends that have gotten engaged. My brother got married this past March that you realize it's not on your timeline. Mm-hmm. Like, this is the GM versus the owner thing. Yeah. The GM's timeline doesn't matter. You're the GM in the relationship. She's the owner. If the owner wants to win, the owner finds either a new GM or starts to incentivize things. So we reached a point, though, where we're both kind of like, if we're going to do this, we probably should get it out of the way, kind of check the box.
Check the box and continue.
As bad as it sounds, yeah.
But I mean, at that point, when you're 10 years in, years in, like, it's kind of where what you've gotten to. You guys lived together for a while before you got engaged at all. So
it's anyway. By the way, pro tip to everyone out there, and I understand that there are some religious beliefs and all that stuff that play into this as well. Take all of the time you can before choosing to marry someone. If the option is there to live together, do it. That's all I'm going to say. Just do it.
So, as you know, very Christian person.
I realized that halfway through that comment, and I was like,
I personally will not do that. Me and my girlfriend are, not planning on doing that. But my brother did. And when my mom came to me in a very, Southern Christian Brazilian woman looks at me, he's like, why is he doing this? I'm like, mom, like you test drive the car before you buy the car.
Yeah.
Like you're going to live together. So it's going to be something that it's going to be the first time he's going to be living with this person. If they do that before they're attached forever, it's probably a good idea. I get that. I
no
get
doubt.
Why you don't want to. I'm not going to do
Listen,
it.
Listen, even when you buy a car, they have a cooling down period.
Yeah.
So that if you... And here's the real thing. I think if you've been together a long time, it's not as necessary.
Yeah.
But at the same time, I'm a mess to live with. This is not about her once again. It's about me. I'm a mess. I'm loud. I'm for the most part, messy.
Games go up to like 1 a.m.?
I mean, with my new schedule now, because Live, Local, and Loud is on in Jacksonville and Orlando until 9 p.m. at night. I'm up till 2 a.m. Yeah. During the playoffs, she's just... She's annoyed as hell. I'm a terrible person to live with, and
just getting that out of the way first, and her.
Well, she knows what she's signing up for.
Yeah, exactly.
Exactly.
You don't feel as bad when you're watching a game at 2 a.m. after you're married, because she knew what she was getting into because you were doing that when you were engaged.
Streaming on the phone has become the fact that streaming technology has developed throughout our relationship. Mm-hmm. The other night, I'm sitting there watching what was the game. It was game six, I guess. It was Rockets, Oklahoma City.
Yeah.
While we're watching something else on TV, I'm like, thank God, because I would not have been able to watch that game in the past.
Yeah, you got to get yourself an iPad or some. You have the AirPods, so just go one AirPod in and then the other AirPod
exactly.
out. Exactly. Let's talk football because
we're way off track here.
I liked it though. It's good so far.
Nah, it's fine. Content.
All right. Division by division. Let's start in the AFC East here.
Mm-hmm.
Pats, I think, end up first. I just think get it. No Brady. Couple big defensive players like Dante Hightower aren't playing. I still think they can win the East. I think Belichick gives you 6 or 7 wins by himself.
Mm-hmm.
And I think a healthy Cam Newton is still better than league average and probably closer to a replacement-level Pro Bowl player. And I think that, alongside with Josh McDaniels offensively and finally being able to move the quarterback instead of just keeping him in the pocket, I think that'll be something that'll give you 10-6. I'm concerned about Skarnecki not being there. I really am. I love
that. That should be
Skarnecki.
The real concern.
I'm really concerned
because
about
one
that.
Of the opt-outs was an offensive lineman,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, it was either Marcus Cannon or Shaq Mason, one of the two.
Cannon.
Yeah, I think
I want to say it was Cannon. Yeah.
So it's concerning, but I still think Belichick, a healthy Newton, enough pieces on the defensive and offensive end, I think they go 10-6 and win the division.
I'm a Buffalo guy.
Buffalo.
I am.
I think they'd go to 10-6 too, but I think they lose the tiebreaker because they lose like maybe 2 games to New England.
It's going to be a competitive division at the top. Miami, I think, is out of it. I think the Jets are out of it. We'll see.
Yeah.
But between those two teams, I think it's going to be competitive. I think Buffalo might be a game, maybe 2 games better. And I'm saying this because I'm terrified to pick against New England and look like a moron.
Yeah.
And I'm the guy that's picked against LeBron in the playoffs basically every single year. But
LeBron isn't as scary as Belichick, though.
Let's not forget that Josh Allen didn't go out and make the deal, but the Bills went out and got Stephon Diggs. They went and got our UCF guy, Gabriel.
Davis.
Yeah, exactly.
Be like, what, their 4th or 5th
Gabe
receiver,
Davis, that's
yeah.
it. Yeah, who's going to be kind of, he's going to be an interesting guy. I'm more interested in him just because we're in Orlando here, mm-hmm. but they've got an intriguing receiving core. That defense is stacked once again. I like McDermott, their head coach. I like Buffalo this year. I think they win the division, but it's going to be close. I think we'll go into week 14, 15 kind of like, this isn't really figured out.
Yeah. I think with Buffalo, it just comes down to the fact that I don't trust Josh Allen. Like, I understand Sean McDermott's
great. And you
great.
Really shouldn't.
Like
I get it.
McDermott's a great head coach.
Game.
Their OC, I can't remember his name right now, is a good OC. Dable, yeah.
It's Dable, yeah.
Brandon Dable?
That
no.
sounds right.
Brian Dable.
Dable is
yeah. Great OC. He does some stuff. But even, like, I understand that the Evil Empire is starting to crack and there's no more Darth Vader. But they still got Palpatine. Palpatine's still there. There's still going to be a mess to overcome. I saw the last Star Wars. It was very hard for Ren am I taking the Star Wars analogy too far?
A little bit. Yeah.
Right. Either way, moving on. I do think they go 10-6 and end up in a wild card spot.
All right.
Jets, Dolphins. I think the Dolphins finish above the Jets. I think the Dolphins are actually competitive this season. 7-9.
I think they will be too. Now my guy Jerry Daniels is a big Dolphins fan. Yeah. I don't know when we see Tua.
That's the question. I was listening to the Athletics podcast with Robert Mays. Bill Barnwell was on it, and he pointed out a pretty good spot there towards around game 9. They had a pretty decent run with the Jets, a bye week, and then the Jets again. That sort of made sense for Tua.
That
so
makes
I think,
a ton of sense.
I think towards the middle of the season, we're going to see our boy Tua. What about the Jets? Any thoughts on them?
I mean, if the Jets finish in last place, that should about do it for Adam Gase, right?
Yeah.
You've got a GM that didn't hire him. You've got a running back that can't stand him. That the minute that they signed Le'Veon Bell, everyone came out and said we didn't want Le'Veon Bell.
Yeah.
I don't know if Bell.
Frank Gore's probably going to get more touches than Le'Veon Bell.
You know, the offense, I get you didn't have Sam Darnold last year, but we've seen plenty of coaches without their starting quarterback, and the offense looks average.
Yeah,
Teddy
Bridgewater went 5-0 last year.
Exactly. I think about the year that Jimmy Garoppolo got hurt, and they had was it Nick Mullen?
Yeah,
is that
exactly.
the kid?
Nick Mullen,
Shanahan, and they're throwing it all over the yard. And I think a Popka's JV team could have beat the Jets last year, or at least racked up more yards because they could move the football. So that's my thought on the Jets. I think Adam Gase is probably on his way out, and it's been a tough hand he's been dealt there.
Didn't draft a receiver. Brought in Frank Gore,
mm-hmm.
lost Robbie Anderson.
Got older, yeah.
Chris Herndon is, I guess the O-line's
Mosley
a little bit better.
Mosley opted out.
Yeah, that's, I love CJ Mosley, man.
I know.
From my Baltimore days. I said when I thought we were going to re-sign him, I said if he re-signs a deal, I'm going to buy a CJ Mosley jersey. Because I hate buying jerseys of guys who don't play for the team like after a while. Like,
okay.
So unless you go like old school, like buy a Kobe jersey or like a Ray Lewis jersey, those guys who played for a team for their entire career. When you buy a jersey of a guy who's mid-career, you don't know what's going to happen next. And if I would have bought that TJ jersey thinking before I thought he was going to resign and he ends up with the Jets, I would have hated myself. I would have thought that was the dumbest move ever and waste of money. Anyway, but yeah, I think Darnold's going to get Rosened.
Wow.
I think they're going to move on and draft somebody next year.
Wow.
I think they're going to be where they are
in the draft. And I would think about the kid from North Dakota State.
Yeah, I love Trey Lance.
I love Trey Lance.
I watched some tape.
I haven't watched enough of him yet.
Skinny Russell Wilson, man.
It's the sexy name right now.
It really
is. That feels kind of like a Jetsian. And by the way, who's their GM?
Joe Douglas.
Exactly. And Joe Douglas was part of the front office that drafted who?
Carson Wentz from North Dakota State.
There we go. Yeah. So maybe that's where it's at.
I mean, I think Douglas fires Gase. Darnold isn't going to re-up. Maybe trade him somewhere. Maybe New England. That'd be funny.
In division? Yikes.
Maybe New England offers a second rounder. Okay. Would you? I mean, I don't know what's going to happen. I think they go like 4-12 last place. To move on to my account, AFC North. Ravens 16-0.
On the table. I know that was. I mean, that was a Colin Cowherd thing.
Cowherd
has them 16-0. It's hard to go 16-0. Obviously, it's harder to go 0-16.
Yeah.
I don't see Baltimore really getting pushed in the AFC North. I think that, especially just because of the whole COVID situation, you've got, the entire roster coming back. Basically, I'm going to take Baltimore there. The question is, who finishes second in that division? Yeah. Is it Pittsburgh or is it Cleveland?
I mean, there's some conversation around the Bengals if Joe Burrow really walks in there.
Okay. Easy. Okay.
I was going to see if you were going to bite on it.
No, they gave Mixon the new deal. I think that offense can pull up some points.
They have some players. Tyler Boyd, AJ Green. They drafted a buddy from Clemson, T. Higgins.
Yeah.
The offensive line's still a question mark, but they have good running backs, good receivers, a quarterback that has a lot of hype around them. So
just
we'll see.
In that division, you got to take your lumps for at least a season. We even saw that with Lamar Jackson. So I think this year they're going to make some noise, kind of like the Cardinals last year, right? Yeah. Where they make some noise and it's like, oh, you know, going into year two here, that's the sexy name or the sexy team. I can't decide between Cleveland and Pittsburgh in terms of second place in that division, and it's because I'm scared of the Ben Roethlisberger revenge tour. Mm-hmm. His wife came out and said they talked about him retiring, which is the least shocking headline of the offseason because Ben talks about retiring every single year. But if he truly is pain-free and they can get through the season healthy, and that starts with James Conner and Jalen Samuel at running back, and Juju Smith-Schuster heard all the noise around him maybe not being a one and coming out of Antonio Brown's shadow, they're very formidable. And they don't have a coach who's in his first year. I'd probably lean slightly Pittsburgh here, but it's going to be close.
So I think Ravens coaching staff, Harbaugh, Roman, and Wink all returning, obviously.
Love it.
The defense might be a little worse without Earl Thomas, but they fixed problems that were real problems last year with Calais Campbell.
What's the deal with the Earl Thomas thing? You're a Ravens fan. Help me out here.
People don't like him.
He's a jerk.
He's just a jerk. He showed up late to meetings. Like he punched Chuck Clark in the face. Granted, Chuck Clark got in his face, but like that's not the first instance of Earl Thomas being a jerk.
Mm-hmm.
And I think maybe it was Cowherd. I don't know exactly who said this, but he got kicked out of two great organizations. It's not like he was on the Lions and causing problems. It's not like he was on, you know, the Cardinals causing. He was at Seattle, who have won a Super Bowl in the past, you know, decade, and the Ravens, who have won a Super Bowl in the past decade. Two coaches who are nothing but amicable towards players in John Harbaugh and Pete Carroll. Everything points to Earl Thomas as a jerk. And I think...
Oh, I agree with you.
I think the players came out and told John Harbaugh, I was like, hey, we took a vote. We don't want him here anymore. They're willing to risk their Super Bowl by taking on probably the best player on that defense.
Very close to it.
Yeah.
I'll follow up with one more point on you, too, is the team he's rumored to be interested in going to, the Dallas Cowboys. Mm-hmm. And, of course, Jerry Jones loves himself a big name. What's Mike McCarthy doing? Ooh, slow the roll.
Yeah.
Mike McCarthy's like, I want good clubhouse chemistry.
Yeah, like pay Dak. Let's focus on paying Dak
exactly.
rather than bringing
in
Earl Thomas.
Don't worry about this dude, yeah.
But I think the defense... has fixed that the issue and their size on the edges with Calais Campbell and Derek Wolfe.
Yeah, I should have mentioned Calais Campbell being there. Great dude, even better player.
That's one of the like you lose that you lose the negativity
talk about
of Earl Thomas.
Presence,
yeah, you bring in the man of the Walter Payton man of the year type dude, which the NFL pushed a lot, by the way, and I love it. Into this locker room, and then you bring in Patrick Queen from LSU in the first round, fix that hole that we had last year without CJ. I think defensively they're better this year, even though talent-wise they're not as good, I think. They'll finish 14-2 first place. I have the Browns.
You took the Browns.
In second. I just think it's too much talent. And
too much pressure on Baker.
But I think Baker's being put in a position to succeed this year. The O-line is fixed. They invested in Austin Hooper. Kevin Stefanski's going to make Baker play like Kirk Cousins.
Mm-hmm.
And their defense is going to be good. I think
the only thing that gives me cause for pause is just the offseason with a new head coach and not being able to be prepared. That's all. Yeah. They have the talent, but they had the talent last year. So, you know, Baker has come out and said a lot of the right things. This is a big season for him because you start getting into that fourth year, fifth year season mm-hmm. for Baker Mayfield, and mm-hmm. you're starting to run out of time with him on the rookie deal. So if they're bad again this year, you talk about Sam Darnold and moving on.
Yeah.
You know, Baker Mayfield, similar situation, but I like Stefanski. You're right, David Njoku, Austin Hooper dual tight end. Mm-hmm. This might be the most successful dual tight end or tight end duo that we've seen since that Hernandez Gronk New England Patriots. And I know bringing up that duo is really saying something because of the success that they had. But those guys and Stefanski likes to use. I mean, look at Kyle Rudolph.
We saw it last
number.
Year with Kyle Rudolph and Irv Smith.
Exactly.
They brought in Irv Smith from Alabama, I think, in the second round. I think Stefanski's a grown-up, and I didn't think about that with Freddie Kitchens, and I think Stefanski, even though he's a first-time head coach, he's not going to walk in there and be overwhelmed like Freddie Kitchens was last year. I just have a question about OBJ. He feels redundant at this point. He feels like I think they're just going to make him run go routes and then just run everything underneath to the tight ends and Jarvis Landry.
Yeah, he feels extra. He does. He feels extra. You know, maybe the 49ers are interested because they're going to be without who's the kid that's hurt there that they had?
Debo?
Debo Samuel for a couple of weeks. Yeah, Debo Samuel's hurt. Yeah, he had surgery.
I love the way that Shanahan uses him.
So maybe, you know, but even then again, in the Samuel offense, I mean, in the Shanahan offense, do you need a bona fide number one like that? I don't know. Seattle could always use another wide receiver. Yeah, I mean, if he gets moved, OBJ for
Tyler Lockett in a first? Going back to...
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, but then again, Seattle's allergic to giving Russell Wilson help. Oh. Just let him cook.
Let Russ cook. Are you on that movement?
Yeah, I'm on the movement, yeah.
I'm starting to get to the point where I think that the argument on Pete's side...
Russell Wilson overrated?
Not that he's... You know how much I love Russell Wilson. Don't you dare put that in my mouth. But the fact that he's most efficient when he's asked to do less...
Yeah, they have to be looking at this like, well, we don't want to put too much on Russell because there's a line there where it's like, okay, there's a line of diminishing returns.
Yeah, if he throws the ball 40 times a game, then he's not going to be as efficient.
I mean, that's kind of how I look at it is like, we all have these statistics where it's like, well, if Peyton Manning threw the ball, you know, 45 times, he's 2-15. It's like, well, yeah, they're behind. But also when you look at some of the metrics, when James Harden shoots 12 to 15 threes, the Rockets have a winning record. When he shoots, you know, 17 to 20, they lose. Some of this just has to do with efficiency, and I imagine that's what they look at it with Russell Wilson, too.
You want to go through the AFC South? Other than the Jaguars sucking and Minshew somehow still being awesome, I have no idea what's going to happen in the AFC South.
Listen,
awesome on the field, just awesome, period. I just like Gardner, Beowulf, Minshew.
I don't know who's going to win that division. I think it's going to be Indy or Houston. I'm not a Tennessee guy.
If the Titans replicate what they did in the postseason, in the regular season, they might be the best team in this division.
Sure. I've seen a lot of Ryan Tannehill. That's all. And I think that Tennessee is going to come to regret giving Ryan Tannehill that much money and that kind of a contract, especially since I don't know if there was that much money sitting out there. Mm-hmm. They brought back Derrick Henry. I really like their coach, Mike Vrabel.
Yeah. Arthur Smith's a pretty good OC, too.
He is. But I kind of like Indy this year. I've always been a Philip Rivers guy. I think we're going to find out whether or not Indy got the Philip Rivers of old or old man Philip Rivers.
Yeah.
Jonathan Taylor in the draft is going to be a nice complement with Marlon Mack. They have the best offensive line in the NFL. They're missing a wide receiver. By the way, update that for an Odell Beckham Jr. spot, though. I don't think Indianapolis is really where he sees his future.
Probably doesn't see it in Cleveland either.
No, probably not. But right now it's T.Y. Hilton, and that's it. They lost Eric Ebron.
Yeah.
They still have Jack Doyle. Okay.
He's okay.
Jack Doyle's still hanging around?
Yeah.
Jack Doyle. They're missing one guy, at least.
It's weird when you look at this division because the best quarterback's in Houston, the best coach is in Indy, and maybe in Tennessee, but I think the best roster is in Tennessee. And it's really hard to flip which one is going to be the thing that overcomes. And I think
none of them in Jacksonville.
Yeah, none of it. I mean, the worst of everything.
The best facial hair is in Jacksonville.
That's true. I mean, the best bologna sandwiches, according to Doug Marone.
Okay.
All right. So I'll take the Colts. I think they feel like the safest pick.
I don't want to root against Deshaun Watson, so I'm not really opinionated about this division.
I like Frank Reich. I like Chris Ballard. The offensive line, like you said, one of the best in football. Jonathan Taylor, Marlon Mack, horns down, are still...
Wow.
You know, I have to throw it out. My girlfriend's a bull. I have to make fun of you guys every now and then. AFC South, it's going to be Chiefs and Reed and Patrick Mahomes.
AFC
elite.
West.
Yeah. AFC West, yes. Mm-hmm. AFC West, the Chiefs and Mahomes and Reed. The defense I don't think will be as good as they were later on in the playoffs.
Now, Spags did an unbelievable job last year. Going and getting Tyrann Mathieu was an unbelievable
Frank
move.
Frank Clark.
I don't think they'll be as good, but then again, I don't know if they're necessarily going to need to be as good.
Yeah.
The funny thing is who finishes second in this division. The Derwin James news this week sucks. I'm
I
a
think
Derwin
the Chargers
James guy.
Are be like close to last. Like they'll be in the conversation for last. Mm-hmm. If John Gruden and Derek Carr don't implode this year, which I think this is the year it happens, I think they might be last in this division.
The Drew Lock hype.
It's
is
fun.
Out there.
It's fun.
It is fun.
You know, I'm a closeted Missouri fan.
I know you are. I think the Denver Broncos have a chance to be very good. They can score a lot of points.
I think they'll be okay. I got them down for 7-9.
7-9. Okay.
Second. I don't trust that offensive line yet, but I think Drew Lock can take the next level, and some of that team will still come up with them.
They went and drafted what? Two wide receivers? They drafted Hamler.
Hamler and Jerry Judy.
Yeah.
And they still have Sutton and Noah Fant.
They're
going to score. And Melvin Gordon and Phillip Lindsay and Royce Freeman. They have players. They have skill players to make Drew Lock's life a little easier. The offensive line is still an issue. The defense is going to be okay, especially with Vic Fangio running the show there. I just think they're not there yet. And it's going to be sort of like the Browns last year.
Okay.
Where they have all the shiny toys, but like the real grit and grind guys aren't there yet. And I think they need those players to actually win football games. And it's going to be better, just not close to the Chiefs.
Yeah, this is way too much time on Chiefs win the AFC West, and it's not going to be much of a conversation. Yeah. NFC North? Is it time for the North?
I was going to go east, but... Like,
all right, go to the east. Go to the east.
But
that's
the
fine.
East is just... It takes... I think we could do a whole podcast on just the Cowboys and the Eagles.
I think we could, too, because it's the question, okay, so who's healthier?
Yeah.
That's it. The Eagles won the division with nobody. I mean, at wide receiver. I mean, they were banged up, and they still won the division. This feels like the Cowboys here, though.
Yeah.
I'm taking the Cowboys. I actually think they're going to be a Super Bowl contender this year. If the Dak stuff doesn't interrupt the locker room and it doesn't feel like it's going to, I like Mike McCarthy. I think Mike McCarthy is going to craft an offense that puts Zeke in the best position.
You were big on McCarthy when they hired him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was like, yep, NFC Championship game, Super Bowl. I still think that's all there and gettable for the Dallas Cowboys as long as that defense can stop someone. And that's really the big question.
And losing Byron Jones is going to hurt.
Yeah. Yeah. But then again, you couldn't pay him that much money.
No.
Miami just... through the nose, paid him way too much money.
I mean, they had the cap room. They paid Eric Flowers.
I know.
Which is still a question. He was okay at guard last year. That's all I will say about Eric Flowers. I'm with you. The Jason Garrett not being there, that bump is going to take them. I remember.
And now he's in New York.
We're not even going to talk about the Giants.
The New
they
York
don't
coaching
to
staff
it.
Is unbelievable. The New York
the
coaching staff. Yeah, the Giants. Yeah, the
Joe
Giants
Judge head coach. Who else? Jason Garrett, OC. Who's the defensive
I'm missing
coordinator?
One more guy. I'll find it. I'm missing one more guy. Is Tom Sula there? Or is he in Dallas? No, Tom Sula might be in
Tom
Dallas.
I want Tom Sula everywhere. Jim Tom Sula is a godsend to me. I love making fun of that mustache. Either way, I think the Cowboys is just... McCarthy's a grown-up, and I think he's not going to get in the way of this team like Jason Garrett did. And that's the biggest compliment I can give Mike McCarthy. He won games when he was in Green Bay. He's a competent offensive mind. I think he's going to realize that Kellen Moore is better at calling plays and won't get in his way for that.
Oh,
and,
Freddie Kitchens is there. That's right. I'm sorry. Freddie Kitchens is there. Yeah.
I didn't know Freddie Kitchens was there.
Yeah, I think he's their tight ends coach, but I just saw the name. I'll find it. But
that's beautiful.
Freddie Kitchens is...
That's a beautiful staff right there. You got special teams guy who I love. I love special teams guy. John Harbaugh. Belichick, special teams guy. You know, he was eventually a defensive coordinator, but he started off as a special teams guy. Eagles injuries are the only storyline that matters with them if they can stay healthy.
Jalen Hurts? Do we see Jalen Hurts?
Probably a little bit. I do think Carson will miss one or two games just because it's Carson. He's my favorite quarterback in this division. One of my favorites in the NFL. He does things that are unbelievable. And I think that him and the great coaching that Doug Peterson has continued to show, even through not having receivers last year, even though the defensive linemen got hurt, even though they don't have linebackers, they still figured it out. And Doug Peterson, I think, is underrated, and maybe not his coaching ability, but his leadership ability.
I agree with you there. And I think we see some of that with Frank Wright, too, in Indy as well. The running back situation for them is a mess. And I know this isn't fantasy football.
Sanders
is good, but I mean, he's banged up all the time. Yeah. You talk about a Leonard Fournette destination, that's an intriguing one to me. You can get him for low dollar value. And if he's the guy he was last year for Jacksonville, I mean, where do you think Leonard Fournette was in the NFL in rushing yards?
You asked me that question, so I'm automatically going to think he's better than I thought he was. Seventh.
He was top 10 in the NFL in rushing
they
yards.
They did pound a rock last
they
year.
Did.
They ran it a lot.
But who do you think led the Jacksonville Jaguars in receptions last year?
Leonard Fournette?
Yes.
No.
Playing in the John DeFilippo offensive scheme, which came from Philadelphia.
Back. DeFilippo's
with my Bears.
Yeah, I was like, he's not there. I was like, they're trying to recreate that.
They got Jay Gruden now.
In Chicago with Matt Nagy and DeFilippo with the Andy Reid system and whatnot. Washington, I think their defense are going to be not bad. I like their
Dwayne Haskins named the starter today.
Dwayne Haskins.
Over under 3 starts for Alex Smith.
I was about to say, I was like, Dwayne Haskins will not finish the season as starter.
I'm right there with you.
I think Ron Rivera is going to look, this defense is actually pretty good. Dwayne Haskins is not going to put us in position to win. Alex Smith will at least make a few throws. And if he's healthy enough to play, I think Alex Smith ends up actually starting a few games. I think Chase Young is going to unlock this defensive line, and they're going to be the scariest defensive line in the NFL.
They still have Josh Allen there too, right?
Josh Allen.
No. Who am I thinking? The other guy from Alabama.
De'Aaron Payne or Jonathan Allen?
Jonathan Allen, thank you.
Oh, they have both of them.
Yeah.
And
they
Montez
do, but
what?
Yes, Jonathan Allen was the name.
Four first-round picks. Oh, yeah, and then Ryan Kerrigan and Matt Ioannidis.
Eventually, you got to start winning some football games. That's
all. All I'm saying is that defensive line will be good. Giants, I don't even want to talk about them.
All right.
Jason Garrett's their OC. Like, what? They're going to take an actually fun offense that wasn't great last year, but it was actually kind of fun, and they're going to Jason Garrett it.
I just want to see Daniel Jones stop fumbling the football. I think he had 22 or 23 fumbles last year. He didn't lose all of them, but he's got to stop fumbling the football. That's what I want to see. I want to see him get the ball out quicker. We all laughed at Dave Gettleman when he made that pick. I still think you overdrafted him.
I still think Dave Gettleman isn't a good general manager.
No, I don't think he is either. I think Dave Gettleman is kind of... I look at him like the three little pigs. He's the wolf.
Yeah.
If you disagree with him, he's going to huff and puff and kind of, you know, try to just use some hot air to push aside the conversation. I'm not a Gettleman guy, but Daniel Jones showed some flashes.
Yeah.
Now, everyone celebrated when he came back and beat the Bucs last year in that game. He regressed quite a bit, and we'll see whether or not, you know, Jason Garrett got a lot out of Dak Prescott. Let's see. Let's see.
I mean, you can give a lot of that credit to Kellen Moore.
I can.
Anyway. NFC North, your account. What are you thinking here with the
this
Bears?
This division, I said this on Live Local and Loud, I think it was this week. Yeah, I think on Monday this week as we're recording this. This division, I think you can make a case for all four teams winning the division.
I don't think you're making a case for the Bears.
Okay.
The Bears are the only team I look at, and I was like, you cannot convince me that they're good enough. Other than Allen Robinson, I don't think there is a tangible offensive weapon that scares anybody. You don't game plan for anybody on this offense.
Okay, and I can see you on that. I think that if you get back to where that offense was 2 years ago, where you could have said similar things in terms of that offense, in terms of the playmakers and the skill guys, you get, and it's not Mitch Trubisky, but you get Nick Foles back into the groove. He's reunited again with John DeFilippo, who is now, I wonder if those guys come just as a package deal.
Yeah.
I'm not quite sure.
Everywhere Foles goes.
In that Matt Nagy system, of course. Can you spread it out and get Nick Foles rolling again and kind of go off tempo and score some points? And really, it's about, can this... Don't forget, they were 7-9 last year. If this off... With Mitch Trubisky, if this offense is even average and the defense is somewhere close to where it was last year, God forbid, the year before...
Yeah, the year before it was special.
I mean, that's a 9-10 win team.
And that's what I think. I think the Nick Foles insertion isn't going to breathe life into this offense.
I mean, this
offense.
Really feels like Jacksonville last year, doesn't it?
It feels like, Nick Foles is okay. Like, can the... And that's the thing. Defenses always regress. They get a year older.
They do.
Get a year worse. And you don't have Vic Fangio. I think that's the real point to me is Fangio not being there like he was
Chuck
2 years
Pagano.
Ago.
I know.
It's okay.
But I think you can make the case, if everything goes perfectly for Chicago, I think of the four teams, you're right. Chicago's the hardest case.
Yeah.
If everything goes perfectly, what it is Foles gets back into, you know,
that RPO sort of system and just kind of makes them
and the defense
more than
is out of their minds.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Eddie Jackson.
Detroit's got some dudes.
I got Detroit finishing second.
I kind of like Detroit. I know. Who do you have finishing first?
Vikings.
Me too. Okay.
I think the QB head coach battle in Green Bay is going to result in some 7-9 season.
They finish third. It gets real ugly. It gets really ugly.
I think 7-9 is what they're going for this year.
I like Minnesota.
Zimmer and Kubiak. What can you go wrong?
Those are
one of the best offensive coordinators who have ever graced the game of football after the Shanahans,
mm-hmm.
and then carry on the tutelage. And Mike Zimmer is probably top 10, top 5 defensive minds in
the
NFL.
And they had to give up only a second round pick for Yannick Ngakoue.
I get it. They lost Diggs, but they replaced him with Justin Jefferson.
Yes.
I don't see the offense taking a huge step back, even though I think they're going to run the ball a lot more, and that means Dalvin Cook might get hurt.
Yep, in a contract year.
Yeah.
We'll see. But he did report to camp, and that was the big question if he would in a contract
year. But I like
year.
Alexander Mattison.
Okay.
He's a decent running back.
Where was he?
He was the backup last year. I don't know where he came from.
Okay.
I've never heard of him before.
I'm trying to remember where he was in college.
I handcuffed him with Dalvin Cook. And so that's the only. And he played a couple games, and he was pretty good.
So, yeah, like I think Minnesota wins that division.
Yeah.
I like their offense defensively. I think Mike Zimmer is thinking about all the disgusting things he's going to do to opposing quarterbacks with Yannick Ngakoue.
Like the secondary, not the second, the corners are.
You lost
still
all three
question.
Of your corners
yeah,
from last year.
You have Mike Hughes there, who first round
back
pick
from injury.
UCF. I don't know who the outside corners is because every report I've read, Mike Hughes is playing in the slot.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously you have Anthony Harris and Harrison Smith at safety, so the secondary isn't going to be bad. I just don't know who's starting at corner for them.
That's a really good question. I got to be honest. I'm not quite locked in on the Minnesota Vikings secondary as much. They got rid of Xavier Rhodes, who was trash
and
last
Wayans.
Year. Trey Waynes. They traded away. No, I'm sorry. That was Detroit who traded away
Darius Slay to Philadelphia.
Yeah. So Minnesota wins the division. If Detroit finishes second, I'm right there with you. It won't surprise me. The big question mark I think is Green Bay. And we'll see.
Does Jordan Love start a game this year?
No,
I don't think so either. Let's just run through these real quick. NFC South. Who do you think wins? This is a fun one though because it's
New Orleans.
I'm going Tampa.
Okay.
I think Breeze takes another step down this year, and I love Sanders, and I don't think they'll be bad. I just think that Tampa Bay has more offensive firepower, and I think Brady holds steady at where he was last year, and because how good the offensive weapons are, they're going to be better.
The Alvin Kamara thing that came out yesterday, it scares me.
Yeah.
It does. That being said, I'm still reading articles about how Brady's dealing with the terminology and figuring that out. It's the first time he's learning.
Do you trust Brady?
Of course I do.
Like,
of course
that's the thing.
I do.
You don't, like, I trust him to figure that stuff out.
He's
a psychopath.
I think the winner of the Week 1 game wins the division. And that game
is still in New Orleans.
And I think New Orleans is one of the teams that's hurt the most by the pandemic because you don't have a home field advantage. But I'm going to go with the team that has the same coach, the same quarterback, the same offensive system, and returning a lot of guys on defense, too.
I'm starting to feel that's getting stale. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They've gone through so many heartbreak after heartbreak. Like, the first time is like, oh, they're going to bounce back and do better. It's gotten to the point where I think they might just be defeated.
There's a point where you're chokers, too. I mean, you can blame the Minnesota miracle or whatever they call it. The dude missed a tackle, too. That's not a miracle.
Yeah.
That's a missed tackle. The
is
guy
that
choked.
Marcus Williams or P.J. Williams? I can't remember.
I think it's
one of the Williams ones.
Yeah, I think it was Marcus Williams. You know, you go to the next season. People don't talk enough about the fact that Drew Brees threw that ugly interception in overtime, and that's why the Rams went to the Super Bowl. And last year, you let Kirk freaking Cousins beat you in the first round of the playoffs.
And make me look bad on Twitter.
On your field.
Made me look
bad on Twitter. Kirk Cousins went in there and beat you on your field.
Yeah.
He was the best quarterback. Drew Brees was the third best quarterback on the field in that game. Taysom Hill was better than he was.
That game, he was. Taysom Hill played really well that game. Atlanta 8-8. I think they're eh.
Bye, Dan Quinn.
Yeah, it really feels that way. Mm-hmm. And Carolina, Matt Rhule has never been good in the first year of taking over a program in college. I think it's going to carry over in the NFL. Teddy Bridgewater's fine. I just think they're going to, other than McCaffrey, there's no real reason to watch the Panthers this year.
They're still the outside. Everyone's talking about Jacksonville being the worst team. They're still an outside. Carolina ends up like 0-7,
yeah.
And it's like, we're going to lean into this and try to go get Trevor Lawrence.
Yeah, I mean, right there, Carolina.
Exactly.
Clemson, there's a connection there. NFC West might be the most competitive and fun division, I think, in the NFL.
I love this division.
It really,
I do.
It's going to be must-watch TV week in, week out.
Three
you have
of them
the
make the playoffs, maybe.
You have, you know, Russell Wilson, you have Shanahan, you have Kyler and Cliff. Like, they're just inventive coaches, and Pete Carroll, inventive offensive coaches, and a couple good quarterbacks, a couple good systems. I really am interested to see if Arizona can take that bounce from last to best. I don't think it will, just because how good the 49ers were. I'm going chalk here. I'm going 49ers win this division.
Here's the intriguing thing, is that each of the last 2 years or 3 years, each of the last 3 years, I think it is, a second-year quarterback has won the NFL's MVP award.
Yeah.
Right? So you go to Mahomes the year before that. And then 3 years ago, I'm trying to remember who it was 3 years ago that won it. And maybe that's where it's up. Maybe it's each of the last 2 years. Now I think about it. But is this Kyler Murray's year?
It's him and Drew Lock, right? Those are the two guys.
Gardner Minshew. Dwayne Haskins. Dwayne Haskins. But yes. No, yes. Daniel Jones.
Yeah.
So all of those guys, odds not that great that it's going to happen, but
you add DeAndre Hopkins and you still have one of the most inventive offensive minds in the NFL. That's what makes you think it's him, as opposed to Drew Lock with Vic Fangio. Even though you get Jerry Jeudy, he's not new Hopkins.
Mm-hmm. The Niners.
I think the best question here is who finishes last in this division.
And it's going to be a team that everyone's disappointed they finished last, but it's like, look at our division.
Yeah. I think it's the Rams.
Well, I hope not. McVay playing with his pit bull in the pool was a lot of fun on Hard Knocks.
I haven't watched one episode of Hard
Knocks. Neither have I. That's all I've watched, because my fiance saw it on social media, and she's like, I want to watch this. So we turned it on until he got done playing with the dog.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think it was more of McVay shirtless, but I wasn't sure.
Probably the dog. Let's just stick with that.
I think the Niners win the division. Mm-hmm. That being said, the Nick Bosa stuff, there's some injury stuff there, as well as the Deebo Samuel injury. They might get off to kind of a tough start in their first three or four games. And that might be the difference, because don't forget, Seattle was a half a yard away from winning that division.
Yeah.
This is the most competitive division in the NFL. I just said it was the NFC North. I changed my mind.
Yeah, it's this one.
It's fun. It's fun because you've got known quarterbacks, known coaches. The offenses are all fun. I think the Niners win the division. Seattle finishes second. Oh, man. I think the Rams finished third. I think all of these teams, I think the most wins is probably 10.
Yeah.
Because they beat each other up.
Yeah. I mean, Seattle always gets 10, so they might just end up winning it. And I think that's it.
Yeah.
Thanks, man. I appreciate you stopping in. I know you got a show to get to. Listen to him on ESPN 690 in Jacksonville. Syndicator, I guess, simulcast, whatever you want to call it.
Whatever it is.
Host of Live Local Now. He is Nicky Football. Much appreciated. You can get him at Get Nick G.
Get Nick G.
Twitter. Great. See you guys.
Night Nation, this is Adam, one half of the dynamic duo that is the Sons of UCF, which is found only on the Nightline Sports Network. Join UCF Mike and I each week as we bring you some of the latest from in and around UCF sports, including such great segments as the Josh Heupel Translator, Top 8 Lists, and Cow of the Week. We'll also bring you some of the most in-depth and unique interviews with some of your favorite former Knights. You don't want to miss a moment, so make sure you subscribe to the Nightline Sports Network wherever you get your podcasts, and we'll take care of the rest. Go Knights. Charge on.
I'm Jeff Allen. Join me each and every week on the Nightline Sports Network for the AAC Report. We bring you in-depth coverage of each school in football, basketball, baseball, softball, soccer, golf, tennis, and more, as well as bring you insider interviews and focus in on the biggest games and news of the week. That's all right here each week on the AAC Report, only on the Nightline Sports Network.
Shout out to Nick for stopping in to talk some football. They call him Nicholas E. Football for a reason. You can follow him on Twitter at GetNickG. And you can listen to his show every night on ESPN 690 in Jacksonville and WDBO 107.3 FM and 580 AM here in Orlando from 7 to 9, 6 to 9 in Jax. They actually do a extra hour there in Jacksonville. So that's awesome. Shout out to Nick for stopping in. Actually, shout out to you for sticking around through this whole thing. That's awesome. Please rate, review, and subscribe to the show. 5 stars are always appreciated. And don't forget that this will be the last time this show will be updated on the old Take a Left at Albuquerque feed. If you're listening on Apple, you'll have to subscribe to the Nightline Sports Network podcast feed, Night Like UCF Night, K-N-I-G-H-T. That is the new exclusive home of the Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast. And home to all of the great Nightline shows like Sons of UCF, Nightline, and the AAC Report with Jeff Allen. A lot of good content there, so you'll be able to check that out as well. And if you're listening on Spotify or Stitcher or Spreaker or any other podcast app, there's going to be a second Take a Left at Albuquerque podcast feed, so you'll need to switch over to that one. Look for the Nightline Sports Network subheading. That should be the kicker as to figuring out which one is which. A quick rule of thumb as well is if there are commercials in one, then that's the right one. If there are no commercials in the other, that's the wrong one, and you'll have to switch over to the Do feed because those will not be updated. Thanks so much for listening again, y'all. I know, again, it's a little annoying to do that, but it's, trust me, the numbers are so much better this way, and it's great for me. And if you like what I'm doing here, please do that. Please support Nightline. It's awesome that you guys are still listening. So go ahead and follow me on Twitter at SamBAlbuquerque. If you want to get in touch with me, go ahead and send me an email at sam.b.albuquerque@gmail.com. You can tweet at me too if you want. I love engaging on Twitter as well. So thanks to you guys, and we'll see you next week on Friday. Peace.